a product called Smart Questioning System. So this presentation is more from the learnings from my project and how it has helped us, and I try to summarize some of the learnings at the end. So this is more of this presentation is more from my learnings from my current project, which I do at Ruckus Wireless. So if you have any clarifications, anything, please do stop me. Anything. So the agenda for today. So just to give a brief, rough overview of what is the current situation of concurrency, the different models available in the market, and what kind of ideas which has influenced the celluloid Ruby framework. And we will see some bit of celluloid code, how we write celluloid code, and how we implement some of the inherit some of the ideas from LLAMP, and some learning from my project. This is the agenda. So I was thinking of trying to come up with different ideas to how we can represent the current situation. It was more easy for me to put a picture because just to see when there's a shared context, obviously there will be some contention happening between two different entities, which means you have to do a lot of write code to make sure they go together well. And if it's more than one, then it becomes even more a problem where you have to synchronize everything. This is where you're locking, all your locking, mutex, everything comes in, which means, which can lead to a lot of developer effort spent being understanding the code, writing the code in a right way. Testing it is difficult, debugging it is difficult. So this is kind of where the situation is. And many of the mainstream languages do this way. And slowly, I think, the new concepts have been coming here for almost more than 10 years. In coming to mainstream. One such idea is the actor model, which we'll talk about today. So apart from locking, coming from a Java background, there are a lot of things which I've seen throughout the evolution of Java. Synchronized locks, re-entrant locks, stamped locks, there are a lot of different things which came up basically to improve the concurrency part of it. One such technique which I wanted to discuss about was the compare and swap, which is a optimistic concurrency, meaning that it allows two different entities, two different threads to run without any locking, and then it fails when it detects that there's a change compared to its old state. This CAS is also supported from a microprocessor perspective. So there are instructions for that, specific instructions for some microprocessors. So some of the Java uses these primitives in the language, and this has been one of the important things. And the next technique mostly is the read versus write parallelism, because we always try to make a balance. Which one do you want? If you want to, for an example is copy and write list. So the read is always not locked, so that the read is always better when two different threads try to access these things. But the write is always taken a copy and then replaced as atomic reference using the CAS. So these kind of concepts are slowly having an evolution. And one of the most important things is STM, which is software transaction memory, which is from Clojure. It's in Clojure Scala, which is a well-designed system for concurrency, because from the name, it's more like a transactional system for memory, taking all the concept from DB. It also uses some of these concepts from CAS, how the refs are implemented, atoms, agents. There are different good constraints which Clojure provides, which I would request everyone to look into it, because comparing this with actors, there are different perspectives. And Richie himself has given some of the dissertations why he has gone this way for STM rather than doing Erlang, which is more towards, from his point of view, more towards distributed programming and other things. So actors, we'll just go through it in the next coming slides. I did want to mention CSV about communicating sequential processes, which is more very, very close to actors, except that how it is synchronized is the only difference. The medium is the only difference. I think if we can get the idea of actors, it's very, very easy to get the CSP concept. So, okay. So why actors, so some of the reasons which I wanted to talk about, three generic reasons being the number of CPU cores, the usual selling stuff, the number of CPU cores are increasing, which means the concurrency, we will be writing more concurrent code going forward, which means we can't handle this code by ourselves, and we are not good at it, and it needs to be abstracted. One example which I can compare to is the garbage collection. We used to do our own manual garbage collection. We know how much of amount of issues we faced with crashing systems and all those things. So that means if there's an abstraction or concurrency as well, where the system takes care of the concurrency and we just use the right constructs and then the program automatically takes care of itself. Still, there will be a lot of possibilities where your system can go into a deadlock state or a wrong state. But that can still happen, but the amount of effort we debug these kind of issues will be reduced because we are not taking care of the basic system. So with this in mind, because of this, as I compared to a GC, it's very easy for us to develop, so very easy to test, and most of the things we don't have to worry because the abstraction is provided from the language ecosystem itself. So the last two points, these three points would apply for all STM and everything. Which is a very good one to compare. The last 2 points is more for the actor way of doing it. Actors mostly represent like an object. There is no difference except that they just communicate with each other through messages, that's it. And they are very good at distributed computing, which means there are a lot of applications like WhatsApp, those kind of real-time applications. You use these kind of concepts to let it crash and fail, make them fail, and then more reliable systems can be done with distributed computing. I don't have much experience in this, but it's more around the concepts which suggest that they are good at distributed computing. Okay, so how do I describe actor model? It's more like just computational objects. Since there's no shared state, we won't avoid shared state, but we don't want to take locks and everything. So the state has to be someplace. So the state usually goes with some actions around it, right? So which means there has to be some computational object which wraps around the state and does all the actions to it. So they're just defined as computational objects. So since this object is responsible for updating its own state, giving out its state, updating its state, there's no shared state between two different objects. Let's see, it'll be better if I go through an example. And how they communicate this by just using asynchronous message communication. So basically everything is like event and react. So I send a message, I get a reply back. So everything is done through that way. And the reason, one of the other things, important things is since it's becoming a computational object which runs as in separate entities, there has to be a lot of transactions happening between these entities, which means they have to be like a lightweight process in the system so that you can launch a lot of instances, a lot of state instances of this so that they can run in the system. And the virtual machine or whatever the system which is running should be able to support these kind of things to have a better concurrency. So this is one of the important things. Yeah, so some of the examples which they use actor model, WhatsApp, RabbitMQ, CouchDB. So, I just wanted to compare Erlang. So this is one voice process in an Erlang system. So when we launch EVM, the Erlang VM, so basically what it does is, it creates, you can have multiple actors in the system. So these are again something like these are like computational entities, as I said. Let's call them for now. It's like different actors in the system. So each actor has to communicate with another actor since the state is very closely related to the actor, which means nobody can access the state except that by contacting the actor. So if an actor has to be contacted, then he has to have an address. So he has a PID or some address by which he contacts the actor. So then, when we try to contact another actor, we want to have some kind of a queue or something which handles all your incoming messages, so that he can handle and then react based upon to the input which comes in. So that's how it works. So every actor can send a hell lot of messages based on the messages received. It can respond back. And basically, these are again lightweight process. These are not actual threads, Ruby threads, or OS native threads. They are these are again a lightweight process, which are like tasks, which are provided by Erlang, which acts like OS. So it has its own processes, and then it has its own scheduler to schedule these processes, which will be using a group of thread pool. On which basically these things run. So the underlying is still the OS native threads, but how it runs is by having another wrapper layer around which it makes these things easier, so that the context switch is not costly for the threads to happen. So basically an actor can create new actors, send and receive messages. This is all it can do. So one example I can give is, assume it's a store, and there are different buyers. So it can be 100 buyers or 1,000 buyers. So they try to buy something. So they send a message, buy. I want to buy this item. Since because the state is based on around the interaction, so the store receives a message, and what it does is it processes the message. It's a queue, so it processes one by one. It's not multi-threaded. So it processes the message one by one. So it takes the first item, and then it based on the item received, it responds. Let's say if it has been quantity, this message says okay, this is successful. Which means it updates this list, and this guy updates his state. Let's say the second buyer time also do the same thing. So if the item is out of stock, this may say that there's no item, so it might error out by giving a response back. So all of these things are not synchronous. Purely from a design perspective, it's very asynchronous. The synchronous way of doing is the CSP approach, where you can do the same thing by a CSP. But from an Erlang and actor model perspective, this is more ideas. So when I see how Erlang, the actor model works, this is an example I can just give off. No locking whatsoever. So just flood it through, so it goes. That's crazy, right? So, and you can find a lot of images like this. So, the other aspect which cellular tries to take, this is a little crash model. So where you don't write the system in such a way that you product the system, make a lot of handling and all those things. It allows you to let the system crash and then revive itself. So basically it avoids a lot of boilerplate load, and it makes your system reliable as well. I can share the experience of my project learning at the end, where we have solved these issues using the little crash model. So I just wanted to just throw some elixir, because one reason I wanted to show how the message passing works, and also it's very close to Ruby, so I just wanted to show. So this starts Elixir application, and after the first time, what it does is it starts another process. It starts another process. So they are lightweight processes, right? So they are not actually it spawns a lightweight process two. And once it goes to this mode, receiving mode, the actor is ready to receive messages. So it does not do anything. So it's a blocking call. And this parallel process, what it starts sending information saying that breach. And once you send the message, it's asynchronous, so this guy receives the message, and what he does is, this is just basically pattern matching, so it just takes the pattern and then says, hello, that's it. So after the first message, it sends the second message saying that shut down. After the first message, what happens is, this is gone through, and then this loop ends, because the receive can only, takes only one. And what happens is, this process is called back again, so that this goes to an infinite regression where it receives again. So this will not cause call-stack explosion, because the airline can take care of tail call regression, or they can optimize tail call optimization, so this is not a problem. But maybe it will be a problem. So it goes to the receive mode again, so that it can receive a second message. So basically the second message is sent, and then we can send it back to the receiver again. So basically, this is how the whole receive way of doing an Erlang works. Elixir can do more than this model, but just wanted to show how this messaging model works, because celluloid takes a different aspect to it. It does not do this way. So here you go. So it's just a Ruby framework for actor concurrency. And it's not very similar to what we saw, like the one Elixir. And it calls the concurrent objects as cells here. So every actor has a thread here. Associated to actor. So the way we can interact with the object is through a proxy object, so it's more internal, but I think we can leave for now. So what celluloid promises is more deadlock-free synchronization, where we don't have to worry about the things we discussed now. And it is also adopting the fault tolerance from Erlang. That was just talking about. So this is one of the libraries, let's say, which has been merged into concurrent library, concurrent to me. So where the typical way of writing is taking a mutex and then synthesizing all the code. So just wanted to show the example, just for the basic example. This is a celluloid way of doing it. So what we do is just say class minion and then just include the celluloid library, and it acts like a normal object, no difference. So when I do a new, even the new is hooked on to, so it can create a proxy object for us and automatically uses class, turn this class into an actor and associate a thread to this class. I just call a message called actor.hello, and this is a more like a synchronous call. This is where I talked about where it's not going to be the same thing like how we do it in the Erlang style. Because this is more suited for Ruby kind of languages. So the way we interact also provides the flavor where you can receive some messages, but it is not accessible from celluloid. So this is just an example. So this is just a synchronous call, this is an asynchronous call, as you see. You can say, call this asynchronously. There can be a bug in this code. Can anyone identify what can in output? This is the output, expected output. Can you even think what might be the expected output? Since it is asynchronous, the main thread can complete before this actor works. So there's a possibility that this might not be printed, but it's a trivial thing. So this is more example around the state. So where we have the state. So since it is a normal object, you can have a state inside these objects, and just do whatever you want to do. So this is a different way of saying. The last example did not have supervised. If you see, they did not have a supervised. It's just an actor. So celluloid also introduces something called the supervising concept from the Erlang way of doing it, where you can supervise a particular actor so that if it crashes, it will automatically revive itself. So what you do is just minion.supervise and give a token name, and this automatically runs, starts running during the initialization, then it starts running. So in this example, what I do is I create 10 threads and then call add on it. Just to show how it could behave. So, I mean, this is not a very typical example because it's Ruby is around GIL and other things. So, where we might get the same output in Ruby, but I think array is not thread safe in Ruby, so we might get wrong results as well. There is a possibility that we get wrong results. Any questions?
If you did two differences pushing to one supervisor, is there a guarantee or like they form?
Yes.
Is that time-based?
Time-based.
So if you've got two services going
So it's the typical mailbox, so whatever message you put, it will be going in the mailbox of the...
Okay.
So it's just a queue, that's it. All of these abstractions are done in the celluloid framework where it has the mailbox. It typically has a mailbox, and all of your messages goes into the mailbox, and it executes it one by one, that's it. Because that's why it has a thread associated to it. So if you see in the last examples, we have always tried to make it sequential. It is not like an asynchronous way of doing it, because all of them are synchronous communication, not asynchronous. So that's where celluloid wanted to do this sequential communication, more apart from the asynchronous way of doing everything, because it may not fit the bill. So how they did it is based on a paper called Atom Modem, which is done for Python. That allows you how to pipeline stuff so that they can make these kind of synchronous calls for actors. So that's the idea. I'll show you an example where you can prevent things like deadlocks. It also supports exclusive mode like Erlang, where you can't do anything with the actor except that so in Erlang, if you have an actor and then it listens to a message, you can't do anything apart from for the wait block. So which means you can't interrupt the actor to do something else. In celluloid, what they allow is you can interrupt an actor to do something else. To give you an example, so this example, we have two different actors, actor 1, actor 2, and what we are doing is we are calling perform function on actor 1. So this gets called, and from this actor, what we do is we call the second actor doing the perform function. What this actor does is this actor calls this actor 1 again. This is a very, very trivial example, but what do you think might happen in this code? One possible case is it can get locked, right? Because you're doing round communication. But what celluloid has done is that's why they don't lock, they don't get deadlocked, so it prints output perfectly fine. Because assume this case, so we start actor 1, instead of message actor 1. Actor 1 starts doing its stuff and then it's calling the second actor, which means it's gonna call the second actor's thread. So this means actor 2 started working. Meanwhile, this guy is waiting for this guy's response, right? So it's waiting for this response, and this actor starts performing its action, and then he calls and he makes another message to the actor 1 again. So at this point in time, what celluloid does is it can intelligently understand that okay, there's another call which is coming in, so it interleaves the current one, suspends that one, and then allows this call to happen. So basically, it can avoid the deadlocks in those kind of cases. But do you think how we can achieve this in Ruby? Any ideas how we can suspend this kind of... basically what we're doing is we're doing something on a thread and then we suspend that particular task and we use the same thread to run another task on that. Yes. So Ruby provides the fibers which are very important in this case. They use fibers to do this. So this example just prints. So when you create a fiber, it does not do anything. And then the first time you have to resume a fiber, you resume the fiber, and it prints this. And then once you think that you can stop this fiber, you can say yield on that, so it stops the computation, stores all this context, and then comes out. And then whenever you want, you can call it back again to resume it. So basically, this is how it implements, celluloid implements it. So yeah, you can see the fiber task getting created for celluloid. For all the tasks are fiber tasks. Created by celluloid, and you can see a lot of to-dos and other things. So, so another example which is interesting for us was the supervisor groups. So what you can do is we can supervise one particular actor, or we can supervise a bunch of actors together. So that's what is called a supervisor group. So here I've used a different example. So pool is something like, instead of one actor, you can say a pool of actors. You can say pool of, I'm saying pool of minions of size 2. So basically, it would allocate each, create a thread per thread based on the number of configurations we pass. So it takes two threads here, and then each is these two minions. And so basically, it initializes these two minions. When I do this run, what it does is it creates the supervisor group and creates two minions, which are initialized. And what I do is I just wanted to give some five tasks, assign some five tasks to it to execute the action. So five times what I do is just call action on this guy. So the minions would bit print five actions. But if you don't, the threads would be the threads would be the same threads getting repeated, because each million has a thread, which means it has allocated two threads. So how many number of tasks you send to this particular group of minions, it knows it's a pool. So it tries to assign one of these workers the task. So that's why it gets repeated here. This is another way of handling a pool of workers. And if you see this particular, every file raise some exception. So what it does is, if this is a timer provided by Celluloid, so you can schedule tasks on the same address. Since it can be interleaved and other things. So what happens is every 5 seconds it raises some exception. And what happens if you see, it raises every 5 seconds and then automatically gets revived. Because it's running as a Celluloid container, so it can automatically manage stuff for us. So we don't have to worry about exceptions. We can remove most of our exception blocks and other things. We don't have to catch them. So other Celluloid features I can think of is you can link between two actors and then make them fail if one fails. Those kind of things. Futures are possible, like how it is done. It's not very similar to a car or something, but more asynchronous way of doing it. And the timers, like the example which I showed you, there are timers, there are finite state machines provided, and you can also work with signaling, but which they don't recommend in Celluloid because that can cause deadlocks easily. So the last two slides. With respect to the project learnings, so we have a lot of Ruby processes, like a rescue processor in our project, where we try to different things like queues, Redis, and other things. Sometimes what happens is sometimes the connection with the queue gets lost, and sometimes process would die. So using Celluloid helps us to clean up all those things, remove all those exceptions, and literally we remove a lot of code because of all these exception handlings. So in this case, we had a pool of analysts. It creates new process workers, and this could be blocking or unblocking. You can do whatever. So because since it's queue, it blocks on this analyst to wait for messages. If there's a message, it calls these process workers to do its process and then come back. And if any one of them die, we can make the whole chain crash again, come back again. So all of those things were really helpful for us. So based on this, we had a lot of exception-free code. And some of the use cases where we had temporary process crashes were rectifiable. We are not able to, especially when sometimes we have to do restart some of these queues or Redis. We don't have to worry about it now because if it crashes, it will revive back. So it get a lot of reliability for us, especially on the production systems. And it was easy to write. Most of the examples, if you see, it is very easy to write. Still, there is some learning curve, but it's very easy to write with Celluloid. And caveats, Ruby has this GIL, so we can't do anything about it, even though there are multiple threads. And actor per thread cannot scale really well like Erlang, or because you have lot of, we create a lot of actors that we have done. So that is not possible. So we tried with JRuby, Rubinius. Rubinius was horrible experience. JRuby was better. But still, there was not a big difference for us. We did not perceive much, but the problem is JRuby does not have a fiber concept, which has been trying. They are trying to implement this in with Quasar or libraries like Quasar and other things. So because of that, it did not work out well probably. And there is some learning curve. And with respect to the library, it was not that mature. With respect to some aspects, the crashing aspects. So we did a lot of testing. We did our own spikes to make sure that it does not crash or come down. So we did some delays and those kind of things, basically understanding the library better to make this work for us. Further topics I just wanted to list down. Reel is based on the Celluloid framework. Spray is another actor-based web server. Elixir, Elixir also has CSP kind of things. And Akka React testing is also getting popular. With respect to the actor concurrency, and the Quasar is the one which we were talking about, our JVM stuff, the lightweight processes for JVM, and so find the difference between CSP and actor. Some of the references, this is what I was talking about, Rich Hickey's idea about how we chose the concurrency, which is a good one, and most of the examples I have it here in my Celluloid examples project, and we did a lot of crash tests in this project for Celluloid. Thank you. Thanks for your time. Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question. So in celluloid, your supervisor runs in a thread as well, right?
Yes.
They run a single thread there. So what, is there anything that supervises the supervisor? Or what if the supervisor crashes?
The supervisor group is another supervisor on your supervisor. You can also have supervisor group within a supervisor group. So
okay, but out of the box, like when you spin up a supervisor, right?
Yes.
Does it automatically have a supervisor that supervises the supervisor?
No, the supervisor itself is a thread.
Correct. But so what if that thread dies? So your actors...
If that particular thread dies, it will bring the whole system.
Oh, so all the actors die?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Can
so that's
have,
why...
Can you have one actor watching from, like, can you have two supervisor managers that watch each other?
And two supervisor actors, sorry?
Managers watch each other, so if one dies, spins itself, the other spins it up.
You want two actors to be part of two different supervisors?
Two managers. If one manager dies, can the other manager spin the first manager back up?
You can, I mean, technically possible, because you can literally... manage all kinds of hand coding if you want, because you're able to link actors.
Yeah.
So you can literally, because it's a registry, if you see how we access the actors is from a registry, so the registry knows all the actors in the system. That's how Erlang also works. So which means you can access all the actors from the system, even though they're registered part of a particular group, which means you can link for a particular actor and another service supervisor group and then make him launch. Definitely. Yes. Correct. Yes. No priority. I mean, if it's free, just schedule the task. If you see the threads, some threads repeated more, repeating more than the other one. So some threads repeated more than the other one. This 9.5 was repeated more than the other one. So this finds, if it finds it free, just schedule the task. That's it. So it queues, that's it. Yeah.
Can you look at what's queue?
Because everything is a mailbox, right? Even a pool, you can assume it's like a mailbox, but served by different things. So it's just an abstraction where you can queue all the messages and then use your free threads to spawn those, work on those actions, that's it.
Do you know if they have thread?
It automatically handles. In this case, we did not do anything. We just call this action, that's it. So celluloid takes care of scheduling that particular task. We don't have to worry about it, which thread does it or how many numbers. So you can scale it based on number of, let's say if you, you know, in some of the project cases where you wanted to increase the pool, you can increase the pool to assume that you can handle the load. Maybe a good example for JRuby, but we can do that. Yep.
Sorry, just testing my understanding. Is this sort of seems a bit like a queue, right? Like it ends up in a queue, and then you have a pool of workers who pull stuff off the queue and
yes.
process it.
Yes.
Okay. But and you mentioned green threads.
Yes.
Is that how it's implemented?
So
there's not it's not even the
in
old
Ruby
thread,
in
right? It's not even the new Ruby threads.
So when you say new Ruby threads,
I thought the green threads are the old stuff that isn't. That doesn't really even.
So it's not equivalent as Erlang because there is no concept of even further scheduled
right.
Minuscule processes which are called green threads.
Yeah.
So that's why they use fibers and other things to simulate the behavior because I don't know if we could try that with fibers by implementing fibers as the minuscule processes in Ruby. I don't know how would that work out. But currently, they don't do that because they are always allocated a thread to a particular actor, which is not the same case with Erlang, because Erlang has a pool of, let's say, it has a pool of threads. All of the processes look the same to Erlang, and then it tries to use these threads, pool of threads, as like something which it can schedule the task, and then stop it, resume it back, do something like that.
So why would we do this? Why would we use this pattern?
Which pattern? I mean, the
actor.
Okay, so two aspects, right? One is the failure aspect, which you would have understood. Because you don't have to worry about all the handling of exceptions and other things. The second part is, when you have to deal with state where you want to lock and other things, you don't have to do that. Because it acts like a normal object, and it can takes care of the concurrency part for you. So you don't have to worry about how to lock, how to mutex, when to lock it. If there are two different mutexes, how do you handle those scenarios? We don't have to worry about that. This wouldn't be the case for typical the project or something like that. That's why if you see the examples, most of them are around the web servers, WhatsApp, those kind of different kind of system. This might not be the case for all different things which we do. That's where maybe STM, those kind of things might perfectly fit. But using CSP, those kind of concept on Elixir, again it opens up these ideas again, but not on Ruby as of now.
Yeah, because I guess a lot of my parallelism problems are all kind of multi-machine, like multiple machines running synchronizations and kind of making sure
yes.
that I don't do multiple things to a user's record at the same time
yeah.
across different machines.
Because we have DB as our
concurrent
synchronized system.
Right.
All right, so you have any question for Alex, you can look for him after that as well. So thank you, Alex,
thank
once
you.
Again.
Thank you.